In case you missed it, this last week, the Climate Prediction Center put out their long-range forecast for how this winter is going to go. What are we going to do rainfall, snowfall-wise? Above average? Below average? What do we think? We're going to go into the discussion on that here, because what they called it was equal chances. That's what they classified California as for this winter. You've got equal chances. What does that mean exactly? It really requires kind of an in-depth discussion so we can come away with our best understanding of what we should or maybe should not expect from this winter based on the long-range outlook. One of the number one things we look at if we're going to do a long-range forecast for winter is what phase of El Niño or La Niña are we in? No doubt those are terms you've heard often in terms of long-term outlooks. Both of those look at sea surface temperatures. That's a crucial factor in making this determination. But it's not the sea surface temperatures off our coast that determine this. If we want to go into the story of La Niña and El Niño and get a better understanding for how it factors into our winter forecast, we've got to go big picture. So for that, we're going to take a look at the sea surface temperatures once again, but we need to do it on a global scale. You can clearly see, looking across the globe as a whole, there's a range of temperatures on here, obviously. Look at the equator. It's lit up. There's a different temperature scheme at the equator. That is where we look to find things like El Niño or La Niña. And those are the two factors. Sometimes it can be neutral and you can have neither, by the way. But that's where we look to see how things are going to be impacted throughout the winter. Here's a quick dive into what those two mean, how we determine them, and how we measure them. First off, let's come back over here. What we care about is not so much what the sea surface temperatures are, like we're looking at here on the globe. We need to look at this in a more nuanced way. Because the way you spot an El Niño or a La Niña is to look at how much warmer or cooler those sea surface temperatures are than average. You miss those details when you look at it this way. You've got to look at it this way. This is the sea surface temperature anomaly map. That is an El Niño. Warm sea surface temperatures along the equator, that's from the El Niño of this winter, by the way. You might have forgotten this, you'd be forgiven. But going into this winter, we were talking about the fact that this was going to be dominated by the influence of El Niño, which typically for California means you should, on average, have a wetter winter than average. That's what El Niño does. This warm pool of water down here at the equator tends to reorient the storm track in such a way that it delivers more storms to California's latitude. And that was a fairly strong El Niño this winter. Let's look at the opposite. This is a La Niña. Total different. Now you've got cooler than average sea surface temperatures down here at the equator. Here's the takeaway on La Niña, and here's why this matters more for this winter. On average, when we go into the phase that's a La Niña, California tends to see less precipitation than normal. Now that is a huge broad brushing statement of average, because as we're about to see in this discussion, it depends on how strong the La Niña is, and even that sometimes doesn't necessarily play in a very useful way for a long-range forecast for the winter. And considering this year we are under the influence of a weak La Niña, that's what that looks like right now. We need to talk about this for a moment. Here's a closer look at that. So we were looking at the equator just a second ago. Peru sits over here. We're looking at the equatorial waters over here. There's a very specific region that the forecasters look at when they're trying to determine if we're in one of these, La Niña or El Niño, and how strong it is. And what you're seeing here is the last 3 months. It's a time lapse. Every week ticks forward. So if you look in the key monitoring region from 3 months ago, watch the progression. More and more blue starts filling into that region. This is the sign that we're going into a La Niña. But it's a weak one. It's not terribly strong. And a relatively weak La Niña makes things a little more difficult if you want to use this as a forecasting tool. And by the way, that's what this is telling us. Here's the forecast going into winter. Small writing, I know, but this gets us into the depth of winter down here. You can kind of see as we're looking towards December, January. That's where the forecast is for where sea surface temperatures in that region are going to be about a half degree below average. That's the technical definition to get you to a La Niña, but just barely. Sometimes that can go as much as 1.5 or 2 or more degrees. If it's just a half degree, this is a very mild La Niña. And here in California, we have some very significant history with weak La Niñas in recent memory. Let's go back to the year 2020. and 2021 for that matter. This is where we were going into the winter of 2020, 2021. That was a moderate La Niña. And we had a really bad winter that year. In fact, it started what became a multi-year drought, because the next year after that, let's go to November 2021. And that shows us where we were heading into that winter. This is winter 2021, 2022. It was another moderate La Niña. We had two moderate strength La Niñas, and we went into what was a significant drought at that time. It can be easy to forget this stuff, I know. But if you just think back to several years ago, you'll no doubt remember. We were talking about a significant drought that we were getting ourselves into a deeper trench on. And then we came to the next winter after that, which was the winter taking us from 2022 into 2023. That was the third La Niña in a row. That does not happen often. We were talking about this when it happened in the news. It's kind of a fun term, actually, that the climate community came up with that. They were referring to this as the triple dip, three La Niñas in a row. And we were really concerned at that point, because we just had two of those, and we went into what was a pretty deep drought for that time period. Now we're entering La Niña year number three, and everyone was worried. But there's some nuance here. The first two were moderate. This third one in the dip was weak, like we're having this year. We had a weak La Niña. Again, you'd be forgiven for forgetting what happened that winter, but it was a monstrous winter. We got so much rain, so much snow in California. This wasn't that long ago. You're looking at an image back here, which takes you back to March of 2023, not that long ago. It was flooding on the Pajaro River. We were talking about rainfall here in San Francisco that was going off the charts. This was a really helpful image that was put together by one of the climate statisticians named Jan Knoll, who did a comparison on where we were for this winter's rainfall. Just in January in San Francisco, we had already reached average for the whole year, and there were plenty more storms that were going to come after that. And people were at that point saying, this winter's way too intense. Is this one of those arc storm winters, which is what we look back to the winter of 1862. That was when the entire Central Valley flooded. It's the worst case scenario from an overwhelming winter. We were on pace for that. Didn't go anywhere near it, thankfully, because the storms gave us a little bit of a break. But it was a big winter. We broke records for snow in the Sierra. This was the year homes were getting crushed by snow because it was so big. All of that came during a weak La Niña. Important kind of clarification. There was another weak La Niña in recent memory. This one goes back to the year 2016. This is November 2016. So that's the winter going 2016-2017. Don't expect you to remember what happened that year, so I'll just show you. Weak La Niña, by March of that winter, we'd gotten so much rain and so much snow, Oroville Dam almost failed. Thankfully, it didn't. But they had to release water through the emergency exit, and they had to evacuate whole towns down in the Sacramento Valley. It was a mess. And it was an overwhelming winter from rain and snow during a weak La Niña. Now, what we know about La Niña is, in general, it's supposed to favor the odds that you should be a little below average in general. But the strength of these things matters. If they're weak, you can't really factor them all that much into the forecast. Take a look at what we did that winter. This was the winter Oroville Dam almost burst. This was the winter before it, where we got about an average amount of rain and snow across California. It was an uneventful winter. We'll take average, it's good. But leading into that winter, this was the winter of 2015-2016. You remember the term Godzilla El Nino? That's what we were talking about leading into that winter. Because it was such a strong El Nino, the opposite side of this. Remember, El Nino is supposed to reorient the storm track in such a way that we get more rain than average. La Niña does the opposite. That one was one of the strongest El Niños. This one was about 3 degrees warmer than average, and everyone was bracing that winter for what was likely going to be a super intense winter, and it turned out to be a mild, very manageable average year. So the takeaway on this for El Niño and La Niña is they are helpful tools, but they are by no means a guarantee. And here's why I'd say they're helpful tools in this, because you can use them for long-range forecasts. We're going to go back to another image that Jan Knoll put together. He used to be one of the chief forecasters for the National Weather Service here in the Bay Area. And since then, he's compiled a wonderful set of data and statistics to help us all wrap our heads around this. This is the average look at what weak La Niñas have produced here in California, going all the way back to the early 50s, 1950s, since we really started keeping track of this. Each weak La Niña gets its own chart over here. If you look at that, most of them come in a little below average. Some of them are way above average. But the takeaway on this is that number right there. If you take every weak La Niña that we've had and just kind of clear out the noise of the extremes, what's the average? What do you typically do? You typically come in a little bit below average. So if we wanted a simplified takeaway on what should we expect from La Niña this winter, that would probably be the safest bet. But as we've just seen, it is by no means a guarantee. So that brings us back to equal chances. This is what the Climate Prediction Center is saying for California for this winter. This is their forecast for December, January, and February. Looks like you could get a little bit above average rain in the Pacific Northwest. That does fit the narrative for what La Niña typically does. And it dries out the desert Southwest. But for the majority of California, no dice. Equal chances mean could go either way. Each one of these gets a 33% chance in that scenario. There's a 33% chance here we could have an above average winter. There's a 33% chance we could have a below average winter. And there's a 33% chance it could hit right on average. That's what they mean by equal chances on the forecast for this winter. So it is a complicated story. There are many other things that go into this. And I just want to throw one caveat into this discussion. So let's go back to that wide view now, because we're going to change what we're looking at on the globe. Rather than looking at sea surface temperatures, we're going to look at what might actually be a much more important aspect of how this winter is going to go for us. We're going to switch from the globe, and we're going to bring this down to scale. I'm going to get rid of the sea surface temperatures. And instead, we're going to take a look across the northern hemisphere right now for any atmospheric rivers. And by now, you've probably also gotten familiar with this term. These are the most important drivers in how our winter is going to go. They deliver the overwhelming majority of rain. But the thing about atmospheric rivers is three or four of them can make or break an entire winter. Like, the majority of our rain throughout the winter really does come from about three or four of these storms. And they can be real finicky in terms of where they make landfall. Let's come back over here for a minute. When we were going into the depths of that drought back in the early 2020s, if you did a review on the winter from 2021, all the atmospheric rivers went to the Pacific Northwest. We didn't get any. We got weak ones. They were moderate. Same thing happened the next winter. So the atmospheric rivers didn't show up. And those two winters, we went into a very significant drought. How'd we get out of that drought? When we finally got to the winter going into 2023, this is when the Pájaro was flooding, this is when the Sierra was buried, those were the atmospheric rivers. There's about four or five of them that were strong in category that made it to California. So the storm track got redirected just at the right time that we lucked out and got the atmospheric rivers. The overwhelming characteristic of winter climatology in the state of California is to swing wildly from one end to the other, meaning way below average or way above average. We do that more than any other part of the country, and that's what this map is trying to communicate on here. Where you get into those deep shades of blue, that shows where in the climatology, going back to the 80s through 2020, you swing as much as 70% around average from one winter to the next. It's a hallmark of California's climate. It's almost a fool's game, really, to try and do a winter outlook in a state where the hallmark of the climatology is to swing back and forth from one extreme to the next. We can try, and we can certainly use El Niño and La Niña. They are helpful tools. We're going to continue to use them and incorporate them into winter outlooks, because sometimes they really do swing the pendulum and change the odds in significant ways. It's not the case this winter, which is why equal chances is what the Climate Prediction Center has said we can expect from this winter. That's this installment of Weather Extra. Thanks for checking it out with us.